This video is sponsored by Card Kingdom. If you click on the link in the description below, it'll take you to their store and they'll know I sent you there. Hello everyone, I'm Neat Sahone and it is Friday, so that means it's time for another MTG Top 10. In today's video, we're going to look at Magic cards that underwent changes during the 11th hour of set design. In other words, something was changed about these cards just before they were sent to the printer. In most of these cases, with one exception, it resulted in a very powerful card. This list, by the way, is not an exhaustive one. In other words, I'm not necessarily talking about every single card that underwent change late in design, but I'm talking about 10 that I find the most interesting or funny. Alright, let's get started. At number 10, I have Archangel's Light. This is a famously bad mythic rare, and it is the one card on this list that hasn't turned out to be really good as a result of the late changes. Instead, it ended up being incredibly bad. The story on Archangel's Light is this. At the last minute, one of the mythic rares from Avacyn Restored was moved to Theros, and now they had to come up with a card to fill that mythic rare slot. And it would be a card they would have no time to test. As a result, they decided to make an intentionally bad card. Deciding that making a bad card at the last minute would be better than just making a card that could end up being busted due to a lack of testing. As a result, we were given what is arguably the worst mythic rare ever printed, Archangel's Light. At number 9, I have Rancor. This one is a little bit contentious because depending on who you ask, Rancor's design happened differently. However, those involved do agree on the following. At the beginning of design, Rancor cost 2 generic and a green mana, and it didn't come back to your hand. Eventually, it was decided that the aura should be pushed, and its cost was changed to a single green mana. Then, really late in the design process, the part where it comes back to your hand was added. This is where the argument within the design team occurred. Some wanted the card returned to the 2 generic and green mana cost, while others maintained it should stay at a single green mana. Those who wanted it costed as 2 generic and a green claimed they actually won the argument, but a mistake was made in sending the card to the printers, while those who wanted it to cost green say they won the argument and the card was printed as intended. Regardless of whose version of events we go with, I think we can say that Rancor received a change at the last minute and adding the return to hand effect on the card while leaving its mana cost at a single green mana resulted in one of the best auras in the game's history. At number 8 is Bloodbraid Elf, a card that, as printed, is so good that it got banned in Modern. It only underwent one small change just before the set went to the printers, but the change made the card strictly better. For most of design, the elf was a 4-mana 2-2 with Haste and Cascade, which, let's be honest, probably still would have been a really good card. But late in design, they decided they really wanted to push the Cascade mechanic, and Bloodbraid Elf had its power go up to 3. While this change is perhaps the smallest of any card on this list, and as a result, the card probably still would have been pretty good without the change, Bloodbraid Elf without a doubt became considerably better thanks to the additional power that was added late in design. At number 7, we have Tarmogoyf, which underwent 2 late changes according to Mark Rosewater. First of all, it originally cost 1 generic and 2 green instead of 1 generic and a green. Second, it didn't have toughness equal to 1 plus the number of card types in all graveyards. It just had toughness equal to the number of card types in all graveyards. The story about how this late change happened is one of the funnier ones on this list, I think. Tarmogoyf had been put in the file for Future Sight and remained there for a long time, but they decided to remove the card late in design for a mono-green Planeswalker. As you probably know, Planeswalkers did not make their debut in Future Sight, instead coming in Lorwyn. Late in design, this change was made. They decided they didn't want to introduce Planeswalkers in Future Sight, and now Tarmogoyf's original slot in the set was open. At this point, Mark Turian, the lead designer for the set, realized he didn't actually have the original design for Tarmogoyf, and he needed to get the cards to the printer, so he reconstructed it from memory. He assumed that, like the other Lurgoyfs, he came with toughness that was equal to 1 plus the number of card types in your graveyard, and he lowered the mana cost because he thought it was too weak at 3 mana. In the end, this change made a huge difference, and for a time at least, Tarmogoyf was one of the best 2-drops in the game, as it wasn't very difficult for it to come down for 2 mana as a 3-4 or a 4-5 or even bigger. He might not have evasion or anything, but that efficiency is difficult to beat. If he'd cost 3 mana and needed at least 1 card type in the graveyard, you can bet that Tarmogoyf would be significantly worse. I think there's even a chance it wouldn't have seen play at all, so this last-minute change had a big impact on the history of competitive Magic. At number 6, we have Oath of Druids, another card whose final form was so good that it had to be banned. In fact, the top 6 cards on this list all got banned in one format or another, showcasing the kinds of colossal problems that can be created by last-minute changes. In the case of Oath of Druids, it was banned in both Extended and Legacy. Anyway, the card that would become Oath of Druids was at the beginning of design a much more expensive enchantment at 3 generic and 2 green for the mana cost, and the effect was not symmetrical. As the design for the set progressed and an entire cycle of oaths that cost 2 mana and had symmetrical effects were designed, they came back to what would become Oath of Druids and made it part of that cycle. So that it would fit the designs of the others, it had its mana cost lowered to only 2, and it was made a symmetrical effect. Problem is, this effect would go on to prove to be really powerful, as players could make the effect essentially not symmetrical, just running 1 or 2 enormously powerful creatures in their deck, and they could search it up with the oath really early in the game and win the game on the spot. Turns out giving people 2 mana ways to cheat huge creatures into play is kind of a bad idea. At number 5, we have Disciple of the Vault, yet another card whose final form was so good it had to be banned. In the case of the Disciple, it was banned in Block, Standard, and Extended. Disciple was actually added to Mirrodin pretty late in design, around 2 months before the set was supposed to be completed, because they decided they wanted a card to mirror Leonin Elder. Originally, the Disciple cost 1 generic and a black, but with about a month to go before it was sent to the printers, they decided to lower its cost to a single black mana so that it would more directly mirror Leonin Elder. Obviously enough, the Disciple for 1 mana ended up being incredibly strong, as it combined very well with the multitude of powerful artifacts in the set, including those that involved sacrificing, with Arcbound Ravager being the most notable example. It is pretty odd how with Oath of Druids and Disciple of the Vault, they decided symmetry between cards was important, and decided it was important way too late in design, before really getting a chance to see what they might be capable of in testing. Luckily, today they seem less intense about making all the cards and cycles cost the same amount of mana, and at least as far as we know, this hasn't happened since then. At number 4, we have Jace the Mind Sculptor, arguably the best planeswalker ever, and a card that would have to be banned in Standard, Modern, and Extended at various times. I think of all the last-minute changes that were made on this list, I can most understand the mistake they made here. Originally, Jace had a different +2 ability. It could mill 2 cards from a player's library. According to Aaron Forsyth, near the end of testing, he gained the Fate Seal +2 ability that he has in his final version. While R&D knew this was better, they changed the ability with the intent of making Jace stronger, they didn't realize just how good an effect like that was. There just weren't that many of them out there. Today, we know that control decks can use that type of ability to create something of a prison effect by making sure that the opponent doesn't draw certain cards and drastically lowering the quality of the opponent's draws. This is very powerful for blue decks, and it is part of what made Jace so good. Now, I do think that even without this ability, Jace probably would have seen play, but I think giving him that new +2 is what really pushed him into busted territory. At number 3, we have Umezawa's Jitei, a card that is banned in Modern. This card underwent a fairly drastic change late in design. The card always cost 2 to play and 2 to equip, and it always did stuff with charge counters. However, as Devin Lowe, who designed the card, has informed us, what it did with those charge counters was changed at the last minute. Originally, instead of having the ability to give creatures -1/-1 with charge counters, you could remove a charge counter to add 2 black mana to your mana pool. Why was this change made? Well, basically because the set's editors realized that they couldn't actually include a mana ability buried within a modal activated ability, as it just didn't work with the rules, in addition to just being super confusing. Devin Lowe and the other designers for the set had to come up with a quick solution for the card, and in the end, they decided to give it the ability to give stuff -1/-1. While the ability to add mana would have probably also been a nice card, making it so that the Jitei could function as removal was certainly better, and it ended up being one of the best equipments we've ever seen as a result. At number 2, we have Arcbound Ravager, a card that had to be banned in both Block and Standard. The Ravager doesn't have the most interesting story of the cards here, but I have it this high because the card has ended up being one of the best cards in the entire game. So, for most of design, Ravager was costed at 3 mana and was the exact same card other than that. However, just before handing the set over to be printed, the design team agreed they wanted to push artifacts in the set, and they lowered Ravager's mana cost to 2. Remember, they also lowered the cost of Disciple of the Vault to 1 mana, and these 2 cards would be used together. They made this change without really having an opportunity to test it. Obviously, the rest is history. If the mission was to push artifact decks, well, R&D succeeded, but maybe they pushed a little too hard because affinity decks were some of the most busted decks we've ever seen, especially in a standard format. To this day, Arcbound Ravager is a key card in almost every format that it's legal in, and this is all thanks to a last-minute change that decreased its mana cost. And at number one is Skullclamp, which is probably the most famous example of a card that was changed at the last minute. This is because it was banned in every format but Vintage pretty quickly after being printed, and it completely warped multiple formats while it was around. Skullclamp underwent lots of changes during development. At first, it was a 3-mana equipment that cost 2 to equip, and all it did was make it so you drew 2 cards when the creature died. They wanted to make the card better, so they also had it give +1/+2 to the creature it was equipped to. Then, later in the design, they lowered the casting and equip cost to 1, at which point it was decided that the card needed to have more of a downside, so it made the equipped creature get +1/-1 now, instead of +1/+2. The problem is, this downside ended up being upside, really, as putting this on a 1-toughness creature meant you got to draw 2 cards for a single mana. According to Aaron Forsyth, during the meeting when this change was made, everyone in the room thought it was a good idea and wasn't concerned about it at all. They had a few weeks to go before the set was sent to the printers, but nobody thought they needed to test the card because they didn't think it would be important. Obviously, that ended up being a huge mistake. Well, that does it for this MTG Top 10. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like it and share it so that others can enjoy it too. If you want to make sure you catch future MTG Top 10s, don't forget to subscribe. And if you want to catch up on the ones I've already made, you should see the playlist on your screen now. Thanks for watching.